Hello students, welcome to our first video, class 8 history, our class 3, chapter 3, ruling the countryside. In our previous video, we have seen how a trading company started ruling a country. In this video, we will discuss about the effect of colonization on a country, focusing on the revenue policies of the company. So let us begin. As mentioned earlier, the British had come to India as traders. Gradually, the situation started changing, especially after the battles of Plassey and Buxar. The company captured some territories and also got the right to collect taxes. After the Battle of Buxar, the Mughal Emperor appointed East India Company the Diwan of Bengal in August 1765. The company had become the Diwan, but it still saw itself primarily as a trader. It wanted a large revenue income, but was unwilling to set up any regular system of assessment and collection. The effort was to increase the revenue as much as it could and buy fine cotton and silk cloth as cheaply as possible. Within 5 years, the value of goods bought by the company in Bengal doubled. Before 1865, the company had purchased goods in India by importing gold and silver from Britain. Now the revenue collected in Bengal could finance the purchase of goods for export. But soon, it was clear that the Bengal economy was facing a deep crisis. Artisans were deserting villages since they were being forced to sell their goods to the company at low prices. Peasants were unable to pay the dues that were being demanded from them. Artisanal production was in decline and agricultural cultivation showed signs of collapse. Then, in 1770, a terrible famine killed 10 million people in Bengal. About one-third of the population was wiped out. Now, if the economy was in ruins, could the company be certain of its revenue income? Most company officials began to feel that investment in land had to be encouraged and agriculture had to be improved. How was this to be done? Agriculture was the main occupation of the Indians. Thus, the chief source of income of the government continued to be land revenue. The British introduced many systems for collecting revenue from the farmers. All of them were very oppressive. Now let us see the various revenue policies implemented by the company in our country. The Ijardari system. The Ijardari system was introduced during the tenure of Warren Hastings. It is also known as the system of auction because the land was given to the highest bidder. In order to take the possession of land, most bidders offered more than they could actually pay. They did not cultivate the land themselves. They had tenants or small farmers to do it for them. The condition of these farmers always remained miserable because the bidders could extract the maximum revenue from them. The company finally introduced the permanent settlement in 1793. Lord Cornwallis made some improvement to remove confusions in the Ijardari system. Since he himself was a landlord in England, his idea was that of fixing the land revenue at a permanent amount. He introduced the permanent settlement in Bengal, Bihar, and a few other areas in 1793. The system gave proprietary rights to zamindars who became permanent owners of the land. They had the right to evict the cultivators for non-payment of their dues or not paying dues in time. The zamindars were required to pay a fixed amount of land revenue to the government every year. If the zamindars failed to pay the fixed amount, they had to lose their zamindari rights. Thus, the company was assured of a fixed return from land and it was also relieved of the trouble of making fresh assessments every year. However, this system also had certain defects. The zamindars did not take interest in improving the fertility of the land. Their objective was to earn without making any investment in land. The peasants suffered the most under this system. They sometimes had to borrow money from the moneylender in order to pay the revenue to the zamindar. Next came the Mahalwari system. The company was now in need of more money to meet its expenses of administration. Many of the company officials were convinced that the system of revenue had to be changed again. In 1822, a new land settlement was introduced on a temporary basis. It was introduced in the Gangetic Valley, northwest provinces, Punjab, and parts of central India. It was devised by Holt Mackenzie, who felt that village was an important unit in North Indian society which needed to be preserved. Under this system, a community unit named Mahal was constituted. This unit was created only for the purpose of revenue collection. The village headmen were held responsible for the collection of land revenue from their respective mahals. In this system, land revenue was not fixed permanently but was revised from time to time on the basis of the produce of a mahal. Then comes the Rayatwari system. The Rayatwari system was tried on a small scale by Captain Alexander Reed in some of the areas that were won by the company from Tipu Sultan. Subsequently, it was developed by Thomas Munro and introduced in Madras and Bombay presidencies. It was gradually extended to the whole of South India and southwestern India. Since in these areas there were no traditional zamindars, the British made the settlements with the actual cultivators or ryots who had been tilling the land for generations. Under this system, cultivators remained the owner of land as long as he paid the land revenue. Land revenue was revised after every 20 or 30 years. The revenue was fixed according to the fertility of the soil. Although the system was not bad in itself, but since the British revenue officials were corrupt and extremely strict in collecting revenue, they used to take away almost half of the net produce as land revenue. Now let us see what were the effects of the land revenue system. All the systems of collecting land revenue were oppressive and were in no way sympathetic to the cultivators. In fact, they added to the misery of the peasantry. The permanent settlement created a class of landlords which ruined the peasantry. The zamindars took no interest in the development of land. They merely became absentee landlords living in Calcutta or other faraway towns, thriving on the income derived from the labor of poor farmers. The land revenue to be paid by peasant was not fixed and dependent on the whims of the landlord. He had the right to evict the peasant from his land. It introduced an element of insecurity among peasants. To avoid ejection from land, the peasants had to borrow money from moneylenders or mahajan. Thus, in order to save themselves from zamindars' oppression, they subjected themselves to the clutches of the moneylenders. Let's rewind what we have learned. The company got the Diwani right in the year 1765. Three new system of land revenue was introduced: the permanent settlement, the Mahalwari system and the Munro system. All the systems of collecting land revenue were oppressive. Let us see what you have grasped today. Here are some questions for you. The question number one is, under whom was the permanent settlement introduced? The options are A. Charles Cornwallis, B. Thomas Munro, C. Holt McKenzie or D. Warren Hastings. And the correct answer is A. Charles Cornwallis. Your next question is, when was the Rayatwari system introduced? And the options are A. 1773, B. 1784, C. 1819 or D. 1820. And the correct answer is D. 1820. Your next question is, the permanent settlement was introduced in the year, and the options are A. 1790, B. 1791, C. 1792 or D. 1793. And the correct answer is D. 1793. It's practice time now, and here is some home task for you. Your first question is, how was the permanent settlement different from the Mahalwari system? Your next question is, describe the main features of the permanent settlement. In our next video, we'll be discussing about crops for Europe and the Blue Rebellion. Till then, take care of yourself, stay home, stay safe. Thank you.